Oh, okay.
All ready?
Yes.
Everybody please stand. Pledge allegiance
to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Can we remain standing for a moment of silence in memory of Lane Henderson, who's the grandmother of Jamie Cash, our high school vice principal? Thank you very much. It's August 22nd, we're at Clinton School Committee meeting. Can I get a motion to approve the bill?
So moved, Mr. Chairman.
Second.
Motion's been made and seconded. All those in favor of approving bills? Unanimous. And can we get a motion to approve the minutes of the July 11th meeting?
So moved, Mr. Chairman.
Motion's been made and seconded. Any comments or corrections to the minutes? There was a second.
Mike, second. Mike.
There being none?
No.
No, no corrections, as usual. Excellent. All those in favor of approving the minutes as submitted. Thank you. We don't have a student, undoubtedly.
Nope, not yet.
PTA? Aha.
Hi.
Hi.
Okay, so it's summertime and we have a few brief updates. For PTA, we are getting ready for our opening activities, starting with the teacher's first day back on Monday. And we have a booth there for teachers to sign up for PTA. And we also supply breakfast the following day, on Tuesday, at all of the schools. And we also have Old Home Day coming up, and we're always looking for help in our booth, set up, break down. And we are also in the midst of getting ready for our Ghosts and Goblins run in October, and we're always looking for help promoting it, talking about it, helping out however you can. So there's lots of things going on, and that's just the beginning of the year. So, and we have a new board that will be coming on, that is on board, and you'll be seeing them throughout the year too.
Awesome.
And the first meeting for PTA will be Thursday, September 15th, and the location has changed. It's now going to be at the Clinton Middle School Library.
What time is that?
It's at 6:30 p.m.
It's where it used to be.
It used to, was it used to be there? Because ever since I've been on, it's been at the elementary school.
And Kelly, the Ghosts and Goblins, the date, and who do people contact if they want to get involved? Teachers,
parents? We do have
parents?
A Facebook page, and also if they want to get in touch with the contact person, would probably be Matt DeLay. He is the chairman of the race.
Through Facebook?
Through Facebook, yes. I'm not sure if his, if anyone really needed, they could contact me and I could hook them up to Matt if they need to. And the race is October 22nd.
Great.
At what time, I'm sorry?
It's 3 o'clock in the afternoon, I believe. But there'll be other activities. We're working with the Parks and Rec. And I know that there's going to be other activities through the day. And I unfortunately haven't made it to a meeting for a few weeks, but I know that there's one coming up next week, so I think the 30th. So is that Monday?
It's Tuesday.
No, the Tuesday. Tuesday is a meeting. So if anyone's interested, you're more than welcome to come to a meeting. It's open to everyone.
Great.
And I could totally get you the information on where it is.
Great.
Mm-hmm. So.
Great. Thank you.
That's PTA. And then CPAC is We had our paint night just a few weeks ago, and it was a good success, and we plan on doing a couple more throughout the year. What we want to do is raise money to possibly have a scholarship at the end of the year for graduation for a child that has special needs, and we're going to work on the criteria of that over the year, but our goal is to have one, at least one scholarship by the end of the school year for a special ed student.
That's great.
Which is phenomenal. And our first meeting is Wednesday, September 14th. We had to change it from our regular first Tuesday of the month because of open houses.
And that's still at the elementary school?
Yes, and we are changing the meeting night from Tuesdays to Wednesdays, I'm sorry.
What time?
6:30 p.m.
6:30 Clinton Elementary?
Yeah.
Clinton Elementary, or, okay.
Yeah, Clinton Elementary. So, and that's all I have.
And you have a presentation coming up with CPAC for basic rights for the families, or?
We have, our basic rights is usually done in March.
In March.
And we are part of the Federation, so they will come in and do the presentation.
They come in the spring?
Yep, yep, we do it every spring.
Great, thank you.
But if you have suggestions for any upcoming, any suggestions for something in the future, we're always open for it.
Thank you.
People should reach out to you for that?
Yep.
Okay, great.
Or anyone on our board, but, and we'll get their names up on the website.
Great.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Mr. Morrison, anything for CTA? Thank you. Mr. Superintendent?
Yes, all right, resignations. We have quite a few. First of all, and I'll just read them off, Kelsey Curran is a fourth grade inclusion teacher. So she's been working in the special education department, and she is resigning to pursue a career in regular education. Jackie Nanoff is the Spanish teacher at Clinton Middle School, and she is resigning to spend more time with her children, her letter says. Samantha Lovewell is the middle school music teacher, and she mentions that she's gotten a position at a school where her commute is significantly less than coming to Clinton every day. And Tiffany Mikulak, who's been 16 years as a Clinton Elementary School teacher, has accepted a job in the Boston Public School District, which is much closer to her home. In fact, I think she told me it's a mile from her house. And finally, two more. Carrie Villeneuve has been one of our best instructional assistants. She's done a great job for us. The past few years, she's been Title I at the Clinton Middle School, and she is resigning to pursue another career. And finally, Dixie Kane is an instructional assistant at the Clinton Middle School, and she and her family are moving to North Carolina.
Oh, wow.
And we wish her luck. So all of those are resignations and openings that we have either posted or have already hired for at this point.
Well, wish them good luck from us. And obviously, with someone like Carrie and Tiffany, you know, that have been with us for so long, thank you for all that time.
All right, leave of absence. One is maternity. Is Megan Hawkins, Clinton Elementary School, and she intends to take a maternity leave beginning mid-September to mid-December. And then the other one is Katie Kluter. Most of us know her as Katie Wynn. She's been 16 years a teacher at the Clinton Elementary School, and she's decided that she would like to take this year off, and she called it for personal growth. And she said, I'm most thankful for my years of experience with Clinton children, families, and staff. And, you know, she would hope to be back in a year, but personal growth. So those are the two leaves. All right, on to the meeting calendar. It's in your packet. We are, the next meeting would be September 12 and then September 26. But the September 26 meeting would be the tri-council, usually 5:30 dinner, and then some kind of presentation and the councils meet. October was a tough month to hold a meeting because there's, well, there's a Monday holiday, of course, and Columbus Day. And then I don't think we all want to be out here during a Halloween night. You know, we should be home giving out candy, I think, but that's up to you folks. That means that we have only really one Monday date that would work, and that would be mid-October. So again, this is up to you folks, but I'm just presenting. So October 17, one meeting only in the middle of the month. If we had it that first week, it would be a week after the September 26 meeting. So, and then November, two regular meetings, November 14 and November 28. And then in December, we traditionally have had one meeting, December 12. So I'm not sure what the pleasure of the board is at this time, but.
Mr. Chairman?
Yes, excuse me.
I'm concerned that it's not enough meetings for the work that we need to do.
I agree.
To use the fall for, among other things, a search committee and to have reports back to that search committee. I'm just concerned that we don't have enough time in the fall. And I don't know if the issue is the fact that we meet on Mondays. I don't know, you know, what the pleasure of the Mondays work for me, but I'm one of five. I also can be flexible if another day works better to line up more dates for us to meet. I was expecting that we would be meeting more and not less during at least during the fall with the number of things that we have on our plate.
Can we do a Tuesday? I mean, or I don't know.
Tuesday would be fine.
Yeah,
Tuesday would be fine.
I'm flexible with dates.
All right. Are we talking about an October?
I don't know if that gains us more, or
No, I mean, I see the point. Certainly, it's just like I said. One is a holiday. The other one,
sure.
Halloween, is a tough night to be out and around.
No, I understand. But
so Tuesday, but what date? God bless you.
Blessing.
Calendar with me.
October 11.
October.
And then the 24th.
Yes, we'd have to stretch it that way. So October 11 would be a Tuesday. Thank you, Mary. And then we would go, the next one would be October, would you say 28?
No, 24th, it would be a Monday.
24 would be
so
a Monday.
It would be a Tuesday after the holiday.
That okay?
So what are the dates again?
24th? Forget the October 17 is gone, and
yep.
It would be Tuesday, October 11, the day after the holiday. And then the next one would be 2 weeks later, back to Monday, is October 24.
Is that enough for what we need to do? Because I was kind of thinking, because I kind of agree with you, Joel. I mean, I think there's a lot to be done in a short period of time. Because you can always add meetings, you can always take them off. If you don't need them, you can take them off. It's hard to add them on.
Agreed.
We used to do this every two weeks we'd meet. Whether
well, this puts us back on that.
Right. It puts
us back having two meetings. If we do it that way.
But is that enough?
Does anyone would it be outrageous to think a couple times maybe we meet like the consecutive week, like maybe a couple times during the fall
Ed, I think that it's not a bad thought to have.
Right,
I mean, if we get to a point where.
Maybe keep it to like one topic too.
Right.
Might be interesting. Like that extra meeting, if you want to call
sure.
it that, would be let's strictly talk about search committee or something.
Yeah, I just don't want to. I'm sorry, Mr. Chairman.
No. I was going to say.
I just don't want us to
have another meeting in October, obviously, between those two.
You find we don't have enough time, when we have it in front of us.
Yeah. I mean, we got two a month except December. Do we want to create another December one?
Probably should.
I guess I would agree with Stephen that it's better to schedule it now and then have the meetings, and then if we don't need them, we can cancel them. But
mm-hmm.
I think it would be hard, especially in December, to try and find time
yes.
to patch one in if we need it.
Yeah.
Would you
suggest adding another meeting in October between the 11th and the 24th, earlier rather than later, or later in the November-December time period?
Well, I mean, if we're going to develop a meeting schedule now, I guess I would advocate for more meetings rather than less.
Right. I'm just asking what dates.
Depending on how the process goes or what we need to do, we can pull them off the calendar at that point.
October has 5 weeks in it if you do Mondays. November has four.
Was there something on the 18th? What was the 18th?
The 18th of...
Between October. So if we had the 11th, if we had three meetings.
Oh, I see what you're saying. Well, we had the 17th, and that's a Monday. So we could do that and just...
Yeah,
so that's three weeks in a row.
Why don't we keep that as a tentative meeting?
A Tuesday, a Monday, and a Monday.
Yep.
So we're going to do that?
So
put October 17 back in, and that's a Monday. So there'll be three meetings in October, a Tuesday, and then a Monday, and a Monday.
What do we do in December?
I think I would just advocate that we do it that way rather than have a less amount of meetings that end up being interminably long because we have so much to get through.
Yeah.
Right.
And I wouldn't go much later than December 12. December's a real tough month, no matter what kind of business we have to do, really. But
thank you.
When's December vacation? When's that?
I think it's the 23rd, I think, or something like that. We go right to the bitter end.
What's that?
It's not that bitter, actually. It's Christmas, but you know. Right.
I guess I would like to say, too, just to add, that if I may, that I respect the fact that the principals are at every meeting, but I think, I don't know that we need to have them here at every meeting. It's important to be here. They may want to be here to speak to certain issues, but if we've got the agenda ahead of time, I don't know that they need to be at every one of those meetings with us and just, I have no problem adding more meetings to this committee, but I want to be sensitive to the work that they need to do as well.
Well, that's good. I'm glad you said that.
Maybe
you want to devote a certain date, let's say, to strictly, the topic, I guess, at hand, the superintendent search, and maybe make that an optional meeting or something like that for them. If they want to come, they can come, but they don't have to come to it.
Right. I think they can review the agenda with you, and you work it out together if they need to be here or not.
Okay, that's fine with me.
Makes sense.
There's no more dates in December that we could squeeze one in?
Yeah.
I'd say earlier we probably should.
Earlier?
Then. Yeah. Well, I don't know, but I don't really think we should go too much. You don't want to go a week later, like the 19th of December.
Well, we've added, three meetings to this proposed schedule? Is that correct?
Two, we've added two.
Kept one, though.
We kept the 17th and we added 19th, two additional.
Yes.
So October we'll have
three. Could do December 5th. We could do a December 5th.
You could do December 5th.
Okay.
Why don't we do that?
I think it's better to schedule it in now while we're all sitting here, while we all have our calendars, and then if we need to cancel it, we can.
December 5th?
Yeah.
Okay.
And that's a Monday. Jan, do you have any problems with this?
Yes.
We'll be on TV.
Yeah, catch it on TV.
I'll find a cub reporter for you. I know a third grader who has his Monday nights free.
We don't have January stuff yet, right?
No. All right, so how's that? Two in September, three in October, two in November, and now two in December. And by then, we should have a pretty good idea of where we are with this thing.
Yeah. Should we have one in early January, just in case?
Well, we'll go over the second semester calendar in December, right?
Just one.
Probably even earlier.
I mean, we could put it in now
if
you wanted, but
yeah, I just rather know ahead of time. Like I said, we can always cancel, but whatever the pleasure of the board is, I'm flexible.
We could wait till like November.
Yeah, it'd be easier, I think, in November
to
reach out that far.
That works. Just throwing it out there.
And then my trustee secretary has reminded me that we do need an official vote on Katie Cluter's leave of absence, because it's a one-year leave. We need an official vote for that from the board.
Sorry. Do I get a motion to approve her one-year leave of absence?
I move that we grant the leave of absence from Mrs. Cluter and wish her well in her sabbatical.
I'll second that.
All right. Motion's been made and seconded. All those in favor?
I get a question.
Yes, go ahead.
So the policy is one, how much, what's the, remind me what the policy says. You give just, a year, that's no problem.
Give a year, and, well, I don't give a year. You give a year, or okay. You can give, you could give, at the end of that year, you could give an additional year if you wanted. I don't think
again.
That's the intention. After that, right. It's usually you come back or.
Right. Is this my concern with leaving? Lengthy leaves of absence. People deserve, and she's been here 16 years, so I'm not saying we're not doing, I'm not saying that because people misunderstand sometimes. I just want to understand, because I want to make sure that the staff and the schools, you know, if they happen to have a great teacher that, you know, after a year it gets hard,
yeah.
You know,
yeah.
To, you have good teachers present. Okay.
Yes.
Right. Thank you.
Anything else?
I'm good. I just want to clarify the policy.
All those in favor? Grafting?
Aye.
Thank
you.
Thank you.
Okay, next up, and we're all set on the calendar then. Do
yes,
we?
Thank you.
Yeah. And now the appointment of school physician, it's just Dr. Lucy is our doctor each year, and I believe you, the contract that hasn't changed in quite a few years is in your packet. I'm looking for a vote to appoint. Oh, no, I'm sorry, okay. But she's been with us, I don't know for how many years at this point.
Since I've been around, yeah. Since family 12, so probably a good 15 years.
Wow. So anyway, I would like a vote to approve of rehiring Dr. Lucy as the school physician.
Can I get a motion to approve? It's usually a formality. I think we do it every
yes.
year.
Yes.
Make the motion.
Okay. Motion's been made.
Yes.
Second.
And seconded.
Who made the motion? I'm sorry.
Mike.
Thank you. Mike and motion and Ed second.
Seconded.
Okay.
Yeah. Any comments or questions?
So what does the I know she does a bunch of stuff. What does the doctor do for us again? Remind me.
She's more of a consult. She does give us standing orders for the school. She was the one that gave us the signature to have Narcan in the school
okay.
system.
And she's easily accessible and everything,
oh,
and everybody's happy with her?
Yes, she's very accessible.
Perfect.
Well, a lot of the kids, she's at the Clinton Hospital, so a lot of
oh,
the
she's
students
local.
Actually have her as a senior nutrition.
That's perfect. Do you know which group she's in?
Hmm?
Which group? Does she have her own practice? Or?
She's Lucy, she's Carson, Hanger, and Dr. Cleary.
Okay, oh, nice.
It's
okay.
Nashway.
Nashway.
Well, Nashway Pediatric has two. She's in Clinton, Nashway Pediatric.
Is in Clinton.
In
Sterling,
yeah.
So they split up a few years.
They split up.
All right.
Okay. Yes, we need a vote.
We need a vote.
Sure.
All those in favor? Dr. Lucy.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay, it's on to the policy JJIF. Amy, if you'd like to come up, you can. I don't know if there'll be any questions. This is on concussion policy. I don't believe we did any changes, but I guess it has to be voted upon every 2 years. Just to stay current.
Right, and this is the first reading, right?
There was no changes since the last
okay,
reading.
That's the key, if there's anything you needed to bring to our attention. Okay.
And there's no changes with the state, they've made no...
Same standard, when we got it, when we did policy, somebody had a template throughout the other school districts. I think she left a copy of the forms, the pre and post participation. I also put in when a student does get a concussion, the form that needs to be filled out by the parent. And it does, you know, what the nurse's job is, the school, the coach, the athletic director. And at the end of each year, the athletic directors have to fill out a survey, I guess, from DPH on how many kids, you know, their concussion is certain school. School sports.
Sorry, Mr. Chairman. And we keep those in one location, where all the policies that are signed by the parent and the kids?
Jack McGrail says it goes out with the packet, and then they're supposed to keep it with them when they go to a game or practice. I personally don't see them because I don't have contact with the athletes.
I think that's what Tony said too.
That's my question. Who checks the checker?
Well, yeah.
That's up to the athletic.
Yeah.
I mean, because it says he was supposed to have them in one local spot. So what's the audit?
I think the middle school, Jack has the middle schools and Tony has the high schools.
And now you got one.
And it's part of the packet.
And now you have one athletic director, correct?
No.
No, you have two, okay. So I guess I'd like to know for next meeting, who checks the checker, where the cap. I thought it was supposed to be one location, I thought. If I read that right. I'll go back.
I mean, they might have one location, make a copy in one location, and the other is supposed to go, I guess, with the coach. That's what Jack Grail told me last week.
I'm all set.
Do we need to find that out, or?
I don't think we need to file to vote on it. I just think we can follow up on it later.
Okay. Do you have a motion then for the first reading?
Just want to make sure we're doing what it says.
Yeah. No, it makes sense.
So this is just for the first reading?
It's the first reading, so if there's any concerns, we can bring it up next time. But it is the same policy as.
So I guess I just, it's not just a question for clarity between our first and second reading. When it comes to returning to play, the final line, and I think, you know, having, we want a medical professional confirming that it, I agree, and I'm sure that it works that way in practice, but it just says that the final return to play in the Clinton Public Schools requires the approval of the school nurse. So I just...
Usually if something happens, they usually, I'll end up getting a copy of the post-clearance from the doctor,
right.
And then I confirm it with the coach.
So just in terms of clarity, so it's final return to play requires the approval of the school nurse
after a licensed professional. And that's because after the paperwork from their physician clearing them to play.
Okay, thanks.
Joel, because this doesn't matter. We're just talking sports.
We're talking about concussions.
Anywhere.
You know, in a science project or something like that, too, or...
Yes.
You know,
right, but the policy is just for school sponsored sports.
That's what the policy is for.
I'm just in the section of return to play.
That's what we have to look at, right?
Right, and it just, you know, the CDC, the state, it's, you know, it has to be a licensed medical professional. So as long as that person is saying... The athlete or the student can return to play,
and
they're coordinating with the school nurse, then that's fine.
Oh, so yeah, it'd be the same process.
Yeah,
but I agree with the policy is more of a school-sponsored sport.
Right.
Obviously, the conceptual of there's a concussion a student has, and for them to return to gym if they have gym class, the process would be the same.
And I understand it completely, and if that's the way it works in practice, that's fine. It just, the way it reads, the final sentence in that section is that the school nurse can give approval for a student athlete to return to play.
Right, that's what's missing.
Okay, right.
We'd like to see that.
So this policy is just for sports.
I guess what I'd just like to see is just an addition to that, that final return to play requires the approval of the school nurse after approval's been given by a licensed medical professional. Just so that there isn't any ambiguity in it.
It says extracurricular athletic activities.
Right, extracurricular athletic activities.
Did everybody get that? What the additional language is just to make sure that in the policy it states that a physician has given approval for that student to return, whether it's to class or...
It's when it comes back from the doctor.
Just to protect our school nurses, that's all.
So the doctor handles the kid, and then...
I understand, so...
Then the school is represented by Amy.
Exactly.
Yeah, the question is... Is the language, does somebody copy down that language so we can approve it for next time?
Which page?
Page 3.
Sorry, it's page 3 in return to play.
The last sentence.
Yeah, I'm sorry, which page again?
Page 3.
Page 3. Under return to play.
Second paragraph.
So final return to play in the Clinton Public Schools requires the approval of the school nurse. And Joel, what's the language you want to add?
So it's just, I mean, it's clear up above that there has to be a licensed medical professional clearing a student to return to play.
Right.
And it's detailed. There are bullet points. But when we have the final sentence say, final return to play requires the approval of the school nurse, I just want to say after after being given authorizations from a licensed medical professional as noted above.
After written approval by the student's doctor?
Yeah. Well, it doesn't have to be a doctor. It has to be a licensed, it could be licensed physician or neuropsychologist or, but it has to be someone who's authorized to have someone who's had a concussion come back on the field.
Wouldn't that be a doctor? I mean, I'm,
I hope so.
I'm
in most cases, yeah.
So why don't we just call it that?
It could be a nurse practitioner working.
But that's what that's what I'm asking. I'm not a nurse or a doctor, so.
I'm not trying to gum up the works.
No, I understand. I just want to get the language so that.
So final return to play in the Clinton Public School requires the approval of the school nurse after written permission.
From a licensed medical professional.
From a licensed medical professional. Thank you.
And again, it's noted above. I don't want us to end.
No, you're right. It does sound like she has the final say.
Right.
Okay.
So we'll have that additional language, and then we should be able to approve.
Thank you.
Okay. Sounds good. So did we get a vote to?
We need one.
Approve this as amended.
Right. But this policy is for the sports, correct?
No, it's for. It's for all any concussions in the district. This happens to be centered on sports, but as Mr. Hastings pointed out, any concussion goes through the same process.
All the same concussions in the.
Because the big push came.
It's a rough high school.
Sports,
I know.
Athletics. That's why that.
But
is.
It does.
But extracurricular, isn't it?
It seems to go out of its way to the first sentence of it says head injuries and concussions in extracurricular athletic activities.
Isn't that
sports? So I mean.
I think the policy that they wanted technically came from MIAA
right.
Yes.
And DPH. I mean, you can still follow the concussion policy
right.
Procedure-wise, but you're not going to ask for pre-clearance for kids to go, you know, downstairs.
I'm saying if the expectation is that this is to treat any concussions anywhere,
right.
Maybe, I mean, the purpose section is that's a part of the document that a lot of people are going to read. And if the expectation is that it is treating any students outside of athletics as anyone in the school, then I think that it should reflect that in the language. Because this, the way the language is now, just it seems like it's going out of its way to say that it's just that it's for sports.
What originally was written for was
for sports.
Right.
That's how I thought it was.
That's not the way. I don't think that's the way that it's.
Well,
it's going
to. If somebody has a concussion, you're still going to triage and send it to the doctor.
Yes.
It's not required for us to report to DPH how many concussions we've had in the school year for a kid that got it during gym class or fell down
right.
the stairs or got hit by something in a classroom.
And that kid couldn't come back to school anyway
exactly.
without
and
right.
that would be, you know,
anyway,
parents,
right?
physicians, that kind of clearance.
Right, but that kid couldn't come back to the science lab.
You know, different
the
than
doctor
than
hasn't
than
said he'd come back to school. And the first line is referring to like a state law, and that is the name of it. We're talking about athletics.
It's just for,
okay.
It's for public service.
It sounds to me that we're pretty well covered. I agree with you.
Yeah.
It is obviously this was made
same,
for
what.
Athletics, but clearly they go through the same procedure and come back. So.
Okay.
Okay. Did we have a vote on that? I don't think we did.
We did not have a vote.
Okay.
So can we vote? To approve it with the amended language as submitted?
Yes.
So
our agenda says policy JJIF, which is the language that comes from the Massachusetts Association of School Committees, citing Mass General Law. My concern came in JL1B, and again I know we have a big agenda, and I'm not trying to add to it, but I just want to be clear that the amendment that I suggested is really in the concussion protocol and
right.
not or procedures and not necessarily the policy, because the policy is JJIF.
Right.
So
do want the JJIF-R.
So you have a need for two votes tonight, then?
That's the regulations.
One we have on the agenda, which is approval of the first reading of the policy, which JJIF is, which I have no problem with whatsoever.
Right, because that's directly from the MIAA.
And just in terms of the procedures and protocols, I just want us to be clear that we've added that stipulation, that I don't want the nurses to be solely responsible for putting a kid back into...
Because JL1B is more of our internal policy that we...
It's a protocol, yeah, driven by the policy.
So, all right, so let's go backwards.
Sorry, Jan.
So let's have the easier one. Why don't we just have a motion to approve the first reading of what was in our agenda, which is...
So moved, Mr. Chairman.
Okay, so...
Second.
That's been made and seconded, and all those in favor of the first reading of JJIF, and then we'll do a separate motion for the first part, which is what he's talking about. Okay, so all those in favor of JJIF first reading.
Okay, thank you.
And now, can we get a motion to approve the amended JL-1B as submitted, which is what you're speaking?
So moved, Mr. Chairman.
Okay. And so we've had a motion made to approve the first and seconded.
And Mike seconded.
All right, so we'll have that resubmitted next week, and our next meeting, and we'll be all set. So all those in favor of that amended language?
Yes, we need that.
Excellent.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Okay. Making my head spin.
Sorry.
That's right. Good catch.
You'll be sorry. That's just good points, Joe.
Yes. Under special needs update,
Can I introduce that, just?
Oh, sure.
Because that's really how it came about. I just...
Okay.
There was a program on the radio this past week. The Disability Law Center had done an investigation of various special needs facilities around the state. And I had brought that concern to Mrs. Buchanan just to, you know, see if we had any students involved with that, and she has done that research. And these are not necessarily corroborated. It's just this was an investigation, and it's still playing. So, but I was concerned. I was concerned that, you know, we get out in front of it and look into it. So, and I understand that
yes.
You have.
Well, just, you know, Kathy did all the work, but I just thought to save some time and just, you know, move this along, that
right.
We did have one student at one of the schools that was in question by this group, and we did not place that student there anyway. The student was placed there by another state agency, and there has been a thorough investigation. Our student was nowhere near the person in question who was fired immediately. They're in different units, totally different buildings. Mm-hmm. And in fact, we have since met with them after all of this investigation went down, and both the child and the parents are very happy with the placement. The student is doing quite well at the school, and, you know, I guess that's about all we could say. We'll continue to monitor it, but our student was not affected by that, and the parents are quite happy with the placement there too. Mike, you probably dealt with the same group.
So I think that it's important for us to know that when something happens to one of our students there, protocol would be for an investigation to take place. Authorities are contacted about what has taken place, but at that point in time, Clinton Schools gets brought to the table, notified as far as what's happening, and then we're briefed as far as what's going on along the way, and then we can make a decision with the family if we want to maintain placement there, or for emergency status, remove the student from there.
Yeah.
So that's the normal protocol.
And Kathy's been in touch with the...
And I just wanted to thank you, Mrs. Buchanan, for doing that work. It was I sort of dropped that up on her lap on Friday, so thank you. Do you want to come up forward? So
I have to share the microphone.
Just a clarification. There's a couple things. First of all, there was one other incident recently that I'm not going to go into because I can't by law, but the school committee and Mr. Ringano are always notified if we have an issue. The other thing is that placements are made by IEP teams,
mm-hmm.
and I'm not even privy to that. I mean, I don't make unilateral decisions, and so therefore school committees don't get involved in IEP meetings unless their student is involved. So just so you know,
if a placement is made and a parent is not happy, usually that is resolved through the due process, through the BSEA, and that's how we handle it. So I just wanted to point that out. But in this case, the parent is happy. There was nothing for us to worry about. And I actually spoke to the schools, so.
I appreciate that. Like I said, it was just, you know, when I heard it on the radio, I just figured I'd bring it to your attention and find out. Hopefully, I was glad to hear that there's nothing.
Yes.
But it did sound important enough to bring it up.
And I'm glad too, because I don't want to.
Right, I'm sure. Thank you for that.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
All right, as requested, we have our tech team here. So why don't you come down. Kathy Fahey is here with Mike McGurkin. Did I get that right, Mike?
Close. Let me get it.
Say it, Mike. What's your last name?
McEckern.
McEckern. Yes. And Mike will be replacing Kathy in
Who's
a week.
Who's not really replacing?
Oh,
I'm sorry.
Yes, most definitely.
I know that.
You've already been through this.
So I'm just happy to say that we have some really, really good additions to the tech staff. First of all, we have Mike, and Mike comes to us from Littleton, where he's been the director of technology. He's been here for a week. He's already got some great ideas. He just really hit the ground running. He likes to put emphasis on customer service, which I think is great. And Mike has been working with us as the tech coordinator for adult ed for the past couple of years, which is how we really got familiar with him. Saw what a great job he was doing there, and we're just really happy that he was willing to join us. So I think Mike's just going to be a great addition to technology here in Clinton. We also have Russ Lowe.
Take
a bow. Russ came to us on a sub basis back in February when Barry first went out. Russ was a lifesaver during PAC. I don't know how I would have gotten through PAC without Russ. He was phenomenal. Russ is quiet, understated. He just does the job. He gets things done. He's a rock. So he's been wonderful to work with. And Russ was just hired permanently in July, so he's going to be working closely with Mike. We also have Megan Calkins, who's a science teacher at the high school. She's going to be working at the high school as part of the technology team during one duty a day. And then Russ and Mike will supplement her time, so if people have questions or problems over and above the time that she can spare, they'll be pitching in to help her out at the high school. And I'm also really happy to say that we now have Christy LaPearl hired as a half-time data specialist. So I know you've heard me talk before about how much we need a data specialist. So it's a start. Christy's been on board for the past week. She took over doing SIMS in the June report, which Laurie McDermott had been doing. So she's already been getting her feet wet doing the state reports, and she'll be doing a whole lot more of them. So. Christy's going to just be a great addition to the staff. So I think it's really exciting to actually have a tech team. So it's all coming together. I feel like I'm leaving Clinton in really, really good hands. So I'm sure there will be some changes. I think they're going to be for the good. I just feel really comfortable.
And you have a new office too?
Yes, Russ Rulam has given us a really nice space in the elementary school. There's going to be enough room for everybody. There'll actually be enough room for equipment, old and new.
It's previously been kind of scattered, correct?
We've been scattered and cramped.
Yes.
So this is working out really well. So it's we're off to a good start here. We have some plans for 2016-2017. We're in the process of purchasing quite a few Chromebooks that will be placed between the middle school and the elementary school. We also just bought 37 more projectors, which should be enough to cover every classroom in the district. We're in the final stages of replacing all the aging desktops at the middle school and high school. We'll be doing that with laptops, so we're going to start that off at the new hire training tomorrow. We'll be giving anybody from the high school and the middle school a laptop to get started. Over the summer, we replaced all the infrastructure at the schools. So we have all new switches, which is going to help with the speed of our connections, as well as help our wireless to work more efficiently. And Mike is planning on introducing a new ticketing system so that problems can be
Fantastic.
Passed on a lot more efficiently.
Instead of each of us getting individual emails or phone calls, we have a ticketing system that people can go and fill out a ticket, and all of us can see it, and we can put out the fires where we need to.
I would say, too, that, first of all, I think it's commendable. Commendable use of resources. It's terrific direction. What you'll also find, too, is where, over the course of time, problems keep coming up, and then you can reallocate resources toward those problems, and you see that as evidence of the ticket system. So, well done.
If I may, that's a great idea. I like that. It's customer service driven, which I like that even better. So when you get a ticket, would that be notify the person that you got the ticket in, so they'll know it's not pending in the air?
Yeah, so the ticket will come in. It will allow the whole tech team to see it.
Right.
I have assigned, like, one school, say that if it's a middle school ticket, actually, Russ will get an email.
Right.
But I can see it on there, and if, say, he's getting overloaded with tickets, 5-6 tickets in a day or quickly, I can go over and help him out or allocate other people.
But there'll be feedback. They'll know the ticket was received. And
they get an automatic feedback saying you submitted a ticket. Then we can fix the issue. We'll put in what happened, what we did, and
email this history, which is awesome.
The customer.
It's a great system.
Yeah. That's what we can facilitate. Excellent. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Sorry.
That's right. That's all that I had. I just welcome to Mike and Russ. And,
well, good luck. And welcome on board. And
Kathy,
thank you so much for all your years.
Yeah. Good luck.
Indeed.
It's been a pleasure. Yeah, it's been a pleasure.
Thank you.
Thank you.
All right. Mrs. Sargent might want to come down. There was a request for a little discussion on middle school flex period. And if you have any questions about that, this is the lady to ask.
I'm assuming everyone here is familiar with what the flex period is. I'll let Amaria do a much better job explaining it than I will. So
at the Clinton Middle School, our day ends with a flex period, which is about 30 minutes, roughly. So flex period was built into a schedule a long time ago. It used to be at the beginning of the day, but called silent reading. Then we moved it to the middle of the day and called it an enrichment period. And now we moved it to the end of the day and called it flex period, because my background is special ed, and I was looking at it as a time for students to be able to get some extra help, get a peer tutor, be able to start their homework, and if they got stuck, they could get assistance right away so they weren't struggling at home. But it's also a feeder for band and chorus, because we needed to build band and chorus so that everybody in band could meet at a certain time, and everybody in chorus would have a set time to meet, because to build that into a schedule, it's very difficult to pull 102 students for band in the middle of the day. So flex period, it works for some, it doesn't work for all. A lot of parents like the students to bring the homework home because they'd like to be part of the homework process. So the last 3 years in doing surveys with the staff, this year it came up higher to get rid of flex than to keep it. However, before meeting with Ed, of course you know that we had an assistant principal search, and that came up at the meeting, and it also came up after the meeting where we stayed for about an hour, hour and a half to discuss flex and talked about setting some guidelines and parameters in keeping flex and just improving on it, which I'm in favor of, because again, I think there's a good purpose for a flex period. It's also because we don't have built-in time for kids who are absent from school to make up tests, to finish projects and, you know, activities like that. It's an opportune time also to be able to use the library if they need to do research. Maybe they need to get on a computer, so we have computer labs available. Our art teacher, Coral, did a nice art program for 7th and 8th graders, but also allowed 6th graders to come back and work on their projects that we do with the museum and so there's a lot of good things with Flex. We just need to tweak it. And meeting with Mr. DeVoe, Ed, we kind of came up with some ideas that would definitely make it better in setting the guidelines.
The catch of it is, like, I think the best portion of that is that any kid, if you're having trouble with one subject, you can go and talk to that teacher during that time. But that also is what makes it difficult to, from a like disciplinary standpoint, because you could at any given time, you could have three kids going to this classroom and two kids going to that classroom and three kids coming back from that classroom. So something was clear with talking to Anne Marie and Terry, and I know, you know, went through, talked to you and Terry about, and then Anne Marie, is would it be worth discussing, having this discussion, some pros and cons, and maybe thinking of some ways that we could, like Anne Marie was saying, like tweak it, strengthen it. You know, it wouldn't be us that would be involved in that level of detail, but just to have it on the agenda and as a discussion, because I think it's a very important program. I think it's very beneficial to the kids. I like having a homework period for the middle school, and if there's a way that we can just change a couple things and salvage that program, I think it's worth at least just having the discussion about it, that's all.
Does it create problems for you contractually?
Yeah.
Not necessarily, because it's not another teaching period. It's a duty. And if it's consistent across the board, it's all about being equitable with dispersing the jobs.
Yeah.
And that's where we were running into some problems, because there were some teachers that didn't necessarily have kids in front of them at that time. Well, the homeroom teacher, as Ed just said, they have their homeroom, but they're also an academic teacher, so they could be getting three kids in, but no one going out. And if they already have 25 or 28 kids in the class, and they're taking three more in, the numbers are climbing.
Well, yeah. And how effective are you as a teacher for extra help if there's 30 kids in the room?
Right. So, and that's really what the staff was looking at. And they thought if we got rid of Flex and built in the additional minutes into the actual academic period, they could stop class at the end of the 48 minutes, and it, whether it's 6 or 10 or 12 minutes extra built in, you know, adding the time from Flex onto the class period, they could be the one to provide, you know, get the kids started on the homework, be there to support them if they needed the extra help then. Break them up. Now, I know that these two are strong. You know, maybe they could work with these two who might need extra help this time, and it could rotate through. So there were some good ideas of why Flex period would no longer be where it would be built into the class period. And who better to give you the extra support but the academic teacher teaching it?
And I don't disagree with that. I thought about that since we talked, and I just don't know if it's realistic for a teacher to do that in a five minute span at the end of a period. As it just, my opinion is that the time to just add 5 minutes at the end of the class, I would rather see that time together in one Flex period at the end of the day. But that's my opinion.
I just have concerns kids wandering all over the school.
They do.
Mm-hmm.
Right. So,
but that's what we have to tweak.
That's
what
the
we
part
really
of it,
have
right.
to get a handle on. Yeah. But in fairness to Band and Chorus, we're only as good as we are because we are able to provide the period.
Not against it. I just like to know, this is the first time I'm hearing it. You know, so this, you guys have talked about it more than we have.
Yeah.
So I would like to see a more detailed plan in writing as to what
I would like
for.
To form a committee. Right. So what we've decided, although it threw off our schedule a little bit because we had voted, the teachers had voted, and I said I would take it out. Well, I put it back in, but in the meantime, we changed our lunches. We're going to go with four lunch periods instead of three because our numbers are excessive. Mm-hmm. When we double up two classes in the cafeteria at one time, there's like 300-400 kids in there, so it becomes
I'm all for
difficult to serve.
Yeah,
that
I'm all
kids.
For any anything that's going to help our kids. However, I want to see a plan that says, if we do this, we're going to get this result. It has to be something that can be measured. I don't want to just guess that, oh, if we try this, this may work.
Yep.
You know, we need to
And I guess I would say, I certainly appreciate the discussion, I appreciate the background on it and what you're thinking, but I don't know that this falls in our purview. I mean, it's, we trust the principal to develop a plan to, you know, to maximize use of academic time. I'm glad to hear about it, come and present and let us know how it's going, but I don't know that this falls.
Well, the only reason that I think it, that it does is from a, like a policy standpoint, because I think having a, there's been problems with homework at the middle school, and I think this program was developed to battle that problem. And before we get rid of a program like that, I appreciate that the staff was surveyed. When we talked, the results of that survey was something like along 60-40?
Yep.
Right, so we don't know what the students think of it, we don't know what the parents think of it, so all we know is that 60% of the teachers are against it. We don't even know why, you know.
Well, I do. I have that information, but we also have pretty much student input too, because those that don't participate in that opportunity to begin homework or do an activity or a part of band or chorus, you know what I mean? So that's a little bit of a sign saying they don't really need this extra time to do it. But our hopes are is that maybe they're silent reading or maybe they're working on a project.
Right.
You know, so.
And just to make one more thing clear, this is, the only thing I'm doing is having a discussion about it. I mean, I've at no point in any time dictated to.
Yeah, no, I don't.
Okay, I just want to make sure that wasn't being implied.
I mean, I want to hear about all of the great things that are going on at the schools. I don't know what we can do with this information.
It isn't. I think, in fairness, I thought it was, this is the best venue to hear about the program. Most of us weren't aware of the program.
Okay.
There had been some concern, and I told Ed that this was the right forum to hear about it.
Yep.
And this is really a progress call on your part as to where you are with it. And it sounds like you know what some of the kinks are, so it sounds like you can work them out. So to your point, we're not stepping in there, but I did think that the best way to hear about it was right here. It's like a progress report. Sounds like something that is being continued. Keep us posted.
How exactly, I appreciate the input, and I have no problem, you know, and I thank you.
So do we have flex time now?
We are.
Flex
is back.
And that's
in
for the chorus and for the desk.
That's really why
it was
we built. Whether it was silent reading or enrichment, or now flex, it's really to have a band and chorus as well as we do.
Because of the scheduling and all that.
Right.
If you haven't checked out some of the work around Genius Time, that extra time that you find in schedules, there's some really great stuff out there to use flex time options. So you've probably seen it.
But. In meeting with Mr. Seed, we have some ideas. It's part of our professional development over the first 2 days of school and to set some guidelines and parameters so that there's consistency across the board. And that's what we're looking for.
Is our hall monitors a possibility that during that time? Because I know traffic of students.
Who would do the hall monitoring?
Are there any teachers available during that flex period that don't have?
Well, that we have that in our minds, but we would also like to see, like, the art teacher offering some extra programs, maybe technology opening up, maybe an extra gym for kids that could use it, you know what I mean? And just rotate it around those activities, but for the main part, focus on getting the homework started, the extra help, support, and maybe bringing back some silent reading as well.
Okay. Yeah, that was just my question, because from my understanding of it, that was the difficult part is the traffic of the children. So if that was a viable option,
we've even thought of maybe having I'm not dating myself, but patrols like eighth graders, some of the stronger, you know, having some students patrol in the hallway, checking for passes. Where are you going? Not that they could discipline, but at least they would know that there were kids in the hall, and we'd have some data collecting.
Right.
For that, and that I used to be one. So.
And all those great ideas to brainstorm, but every time we do some changes like that, it requires a lot of management. It takes time, mm-hmm. from teachers and students, and it gets busy. And you guys, your school has a bigger population of all the schools right now, to include Flag. You have a lot of people in that school. You know, whatever you decide, you're the principal, you know, live and die by those decisions. But I'm telling you, you know, don't ever feel, you do what's best for your school, is what I'm telling you.
Thank you.
Okay, that's, you know, I'll support what you want to do. But, you know, I may say, you know, your head, but that's just a question.
Exactly.
You do what you think is best for your school. Again, I'm sensitive to the fact that you have more kids than anybody else, and to include Flag, and it's busy over there.
It is.
So.
We love it.
No, you love it, but the reality, it's busy. It creates different challenges.
It does. Yeah, but I appreciate that you brought it up, you know,
right,
that you brought it to me, and we could talk about it, and I could let you know what was going on.
Exactly.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Thank you.
I will pass these.
Yes. I just want to go through this quickly. Robert, that's for you afterwards.
Some of us do.
You already have that. Just quickly, it's two-sided. I thought it would be time to update you on what's going on this summer. I had promised a lot of professional development, and it has pretty much worked out exactly the way I wanted it to. So I just have this in sections very quickly. Professional development, we had 17 staff members trained in CPR and first aid. I won't go through this, but we had 30 teachers participate in curriculum mapping and updating their curriculum. And you can see that many, many of them are science and technology. We now have a formal curriculum in science and technology in grade 4 and grade 2. A lot of the science teachers on like the grade 6, 7, 8 and high school level have now developed their, you know, renewed their curriculum guides with the new frameworks that came out. So that really played out quite well. We had 3 new teachers trained to be mentors. 7 teachers took a course from another staff member called Theory of Mind, Emotional Intelligence. 16 of us actually completed a special education class online through our PD program called Edovation. I tried my first ever book study group with 6 administrators on the effects of poverty on student achievement, which was pretty good. It was good, and we're still working on it, but we're just about wrapping it up. And then today, in fact, we hosted the DESE Inclusive Ambassador. It's a new thing that they're doing all over the state. They're visiting schools and talking, doing a brief presentation on ways that we can help specialized populations, ELL students, special ed students, students in poverty. So it's funny, the woman said, you know, it kind of worked right into what we're already doing with the book study from administrators. As far as capital improvements, we have Tom Liddy working hard, painting offices all over the central office a bright, beautiful yellow color. We had the roof repaired at the middle school. I think you probably heard that we had some serious damage. I think it was a windstorm or something, and sometime maybe April or May, and insurance money paid for this, $80,000 to fix the roof at the middle school. Mr. Rulo ordered a lot of the new fashion rubberized mulch for the elementary playgrounds. We're actually ready to implement a new facility software program, SchoolDude, which is a pretty popular, you guys probably use it already, but we're starting to do that. The back parking lot was done this past weekend, the first phase of it. So they scraped it completely clean, and it looks pretty darn good. It really does. The next step, of course, is to get the DPW in to put down the road shavings or whatever. But I was very pleased with the way it came out. And then, of course, thanks to Karen's work, we're leasing all new Xerox photocopiers throughout the districts. They're being set up now in every one of the schools and in the central office. We had major repairs in all of the lavatories in the central office building. The building is so old, it was rehabbed in 76. A lot of the urinals and bathrooms don't work properly, and the building is heavily used. Adult ed at night, so we had a lot of work done on that. We're working on the new phone system, which was passed at the town meeting. Phase one, I could have Ed talk about that, but people are wondering about the track, and the first part of the track that the long jump was handled, I guess, completely on a volunteer basis. Ed was involved, and Chris McGowan, and Bates and Sons?
Yes, I always confuse the two of them. So I because there's two Bates Constructions, and I always confuse which one it is. That's,
okay.
But Jimmy Lernard is helping us out with it. And they...
it's been dug.
They dug the pit out.
Yep.
They put the sand down. The trench has been dug out. So the next step is to get some local support from local businesses to put the asphalt down on the runway. And then the only part of the project that is will be coming out of the school's budget is the
yes.
money for the surfacing of the
yes.
Of the runway.
Yes, yeah, and that's coming out of town meeting,
right.
The town meeting warrant article, and that's the final sort of rubberized asphalt surface and many lines and all of that. That's probably probably the same company that did our track will probably do that, but that'll be involving the formal bidding process and all of that. This first part that Ed and others have handled has all been voluntary, all free.
Yeah, and
we certainly thank them.
When the project's finished, we'll properly thank
yes.
the Bates Construction
yes.
and everyone that's involved.
Ed and I have even talked about some kind of, I don't know what, ribbon cutting ceremony or something. We never really did do anything with the track.
Right.
Such a huge project. The town really came through for us.
But
we're actually all set to host a spring meet. Regional, like a district, which is what we wanted in the first place. So
right.
maybe somewhere along the line, we ought to have a little ceremony of some kind.
That's what I just wanted to remind everyone. That was the purpose behind this, was that we put all this money into the track, and then we were just one long jump pit away from being able to use it for mm-hmm. district meets and state meets. And the track officials loved our facility, and Coach Gannon talked about how much the officials loved our facilities and how much they wanted to have a district meet or a state meet there,
yeah.
but we couldn't because the rule says you have to have two long jump pits. So I felt it was worth it. Now all the money that we put in, we can really put that track on display for the
yeah.
whole state and other
yeah.
families coming
into
the town.
The good news is we get the concession stand and the notoriety, which we like as well. So. The preschool and daycare is now being handled by my office. We've restructured the whole process, and the payments are really now starting to come in. We've had a tough time in the past of collecting the monies from people. A lot of people in this town are hurting. Obviously, if preschool or daycare is free for some people, and that's fine. But we're talking about the people who can afford to pay, and we've had trouble collecting. And now it seems to be coming together much, much better. We're expanding the use of Budget Sense now. We're going web-based, which will help us in the future. And we just met just about the entire new technology team, and they even set up a new office too. And Mike is setting up a new system too. The grant updates, I wish I was as pleased with those, but I just want you to be informed of what's going on with the grants. As you know, I think it was at the last school committee meeting on July 11 is when we officially found out that the K grant was not funded, so the district is out $85,000. So there's 7 kindergarten classes. We were able to with other money, fund 4 of those positions. But the other 3 have been lost. The people have gone to other positions, other open positions. You've read about some of the people who've left earlier in the evening. So no one has lost a job. The trouble is the kindergarten is, it's going to be a tough year. We will put that money back in the budget next year in the hopes that we, or hope the grant comes back, but I don't think it will. But it's going to involve more work from the kindergarten teachers, much more structured schedule for the teachers as to what activities they're doing, because they're going to be sharing the aides. So no kindergarten class will not have an aide. It's just that they're going to be, one aide may be going between 2 classrooms that are side by side with an adjoining door. Not the greatest model, but that's what happens when the state cuts $85,000 that late in the process too. Title I is down $51,000. So Kathy DeVarney is a reading teacher who just retired at the middle school, and we could not afford to replace her. And because of that, we had to take the Title I reading, one of the Title I reading teachers at Clinton Elementary, and move them to Clinton Middle. We also, as part of that, lost one Title I aide. So Title I is hurting, and that, of course, helps the kids who really need the help. And we hope this comes back. Remember, the state has decided to count students in poverty in a different way. So suddenly, according to the state, I think we're at like 33% poverty here in Clinton. And a year ago, we were at more like 51, 52%, which is really the legitimate number. So they're just finding a different way to save their money, I guess. Title IIA is down $3,000. Title III was especially annoying. It's an annoying grant to write, believe me. This year it's $20,000, and it's for ESL students. And those are the kids who really need the help. And every year that grant pays for one aide in an ESL program. We have quite a few, but it pays for one, happens to be at the Clinton Middle School. And then it also pays for after school program. It's called a homework club at each of the schools. It's only for ELL students, because they are the ones who really, really need it. This program is. And then also, we just got through with it recently, just completed an ESL summer program, so those kids don't slide back. Well, the grant was cut so much that, you know, and I know it's not much, $3,000, but at least that allowed us a little bit of room. So now the grant doesn't even pay for the one aide anymore. So it pays for, you know, maybe 90% of her salary. So the you know, the general fund will have to pick up the difference, but at least at the moment, there is no money for an after-school program for ESL students, and there is no money for an ESL summer program. Sometimes money comes out during the year, and that's what we're hoping for. But I think it's all kind of linked anyway. This year, quite late in May, I wrote a grant for $625 for transportation for our ESL summer school. So it was almost like extra money they found, and they, in any group that was doing a summer school, was like, how can you use, you want to use this money? So we did. But now I don't know what happens next, because we're not going to have a summer school. So I don't know if they're going to come up with more money or not. Another disappointment from the state is the academic support grant. It was going down every year. When I started writing the grants 11 years ago, it was $12,000. And this is to help students, only those students in the needs improvement or failure category of MCAS. And it, every year it went down. Last year it was $5,000. This year it's gone completely. So there is no extra tutoring services for those students who really need the help from MCAS scores. And then we did write a new grant for $28,000, written by Dave Vanass and Karen and myself, on something called School Equipment Assistant Grants. And we put in for a couple of big pieces of equipment for Mr. Vanass and his staff. We have no idea if it's going to work or not. You know, you have to be a certain income level and all, and we fit all of that, but I'm sure there's many, many people looking for this. I also just heard today, and I had nothing to do with it, but I believe the Ween Foundation funded the music department at the middle school for something like $7,000, wow, all for new instruments, new band instruments. And so I was thrilled to hear that. So that's just an update of what's going on this summer. We've done a lot. We're working hard. I'll continue to keep you updated on the grants. We took a major hit. And the only thing that bothered me a little bit about it all was I'm hearing people talking about, like, the override. We gave money for the override. This has nothing to do with the override. This was when we created the budget, we were told that the state would probably level fund the grants that we have already been getting. So we go on that judgment. If they had, sometimes, some years, they've said expect a 10% cut or expect a 20% cut. we didn't get any of those words at all this time. It was pretty much level funded because of the type of community we are. And then, the town budget passed in what? Very early June, and it really wasn't until the end of June when the state finally officially decided no kindergarten grant and no academic support grant. So it was too late for us to throw in another $85,000. We do have some extra money. I shouldn't call it extra, but we're using that to fund some of the special ed positions that had to happen, that were cut by the town, that had to happen at the Clinton Middle School. A new ABA teacher and two ABA aides. That money was cut, the $345,000 cut from the town. So we're using that excess to fund that. We're trying to be creative in our use of money. We cut down on a lot of stipends. We stopped stipends, put them together, and that's how we're funding our data specialist, our part-time data specialist, because so many people are doing so many things around here, and we were giving, you know, 2,000 extra here or 3,000 extra here just to have them do this extra job. We took those away from those people. Some of them were glad to get rid of the duty, and others were upset at the lack of the stipend. And we put them together to fund Christie's part-time job, which I think is really going to help us. So many reports from the state. So that is where we are. It's not the greatest news, but we will survive.
So, you know, great job as far as give us a snapshot as far as, you know, the grants of where we're losing money. Is there any way where we could get an overall update of the grants for our next meeting as far as where we stand for all of them?
Sure, we can do that. Yeah, I mean, some of them are quite late. Kathy's were quite late coming out this year, like SPED grants. So, last week, I was surprised. Yeah, even this Title III came out last week. That usually comes out much earlier than that, so I don't know what's going on.
Right, so some of them, you know, haven't come out late. Some of them are, you know, late to the table, but some of them have been told throughout the state as far as what you're going to be allocated for.
Oh, absolutely, yes. Title I has already been even accepted. It
right.
took 24 hours, and
so
they accepted.
So if we could have, you know, a list of the grants,
we can do
and
that.
Then we know as far as what has already come out, and then maybe if they're not out yet, the dates as far as when they're going to be there, and then what has been the potential allocation for those that haven't come out yet.
Okay, yep, we can do that. All right, that's it for summer projects.
I got a quick question on that. On the ESL?
Yes.
How many students are affected by that? Do we have a number?
How so? I mean, like the summer program, I think there were about maybe 20 students, mostly elementary students, that did the last 2 years have done ESL summer school.
Mm-hmm.
And again, because it's still a year away, mm-hmm. there might be some money that shows up from the state, but that's 20 students.
Okay.
The after-school program differed. In some schools where the kids don't stay after school or can't stay after school, we don't get a lot of business with that. But like at the high school, we get quite a few students who stay with either Brenda Seymour or Blanca Brusso and are part of this program.
Okay.
So that's going to hurt.
Yeah, and the reason my question really ties into, like, if they need help with the language, that could potentially affect, it may not, but it could affect scores.
Absolutely. I hate to say it, Steve, but probably every one of those things is going to affect scores.
Mm-hmm.
The academic support is built for the kid who didn't do well in MCAS. And now it's gone.
Thank you.
Mr. Chairman.
Thank you very much. So, role of the school committee. I this came up indirectly. We had an informal meeting to follow up on a basically a NIPRO issue, which I hadn't really heard about, and I had time to go to a meeting. And I think the clarification, without going into detail about that, it was an AP related issue. But one of the things that I felt is that a lot of times things come up and we could address them as policy. I think I'll throw this out, I'm not advocating either direction, but for instance, if AP is open for any student who wants to take an AP course, well, that's well and good, but then the quality of the work perhaps may not be judged correctly. If we're opening to everybody, our AP scores may not hold up to scrutiny. Now that, there's all kinds of philosophy here. But I think that as a school committee, if it's felt that we want to tighten the academic standard and we want to make that, I think that that's where the school committee can provide a policy approach. I'm throwing that out. Because a lot of times, I think members of the committee hear about things in the community or from teachers or from wherever. It doesn't matter where it is. And if in fact, it's an issue that we can address, and we can address it through policy, because that's our only responsibility, is policy and obviously the superintendent, then I think that's, this is where it belongs. I think that's in a worthy.
And budget.
And budget, but worthy discussion. And, you know, the budget's a great thing, but the fact of the matter is that we can push for certain directions in the budget, but we obviously have some real big constraints in terms of our numbers. So I think academic standards and what direction we want the district to go is something that we can have some influence. That also has to do with and this also came, I heard some comment, you know, we had an administrative change at the middle school. Personally, I feel like if it needs to be articulated as a policy, that the communication should come at least to the chair so that I can inform the school committee that there's a change afoot. It's not our role to have any play in that, but I do think that because it's such an important role, that the school committee should know about this. And I think that one of the things that was addressed in the teacher's contract was that we would use school spring for all positions that were open. And I do believe that even if we just have some candidate, I do believe that as a school committee, we can propose that everything goes in school spring, that the field of candidates, whether it's inside or outside, it's an even playing field, and that we're giving people the opportunity to...
And you can make that a policy.
Yeah.
And everything still goes on school spring, always. But the question is internal versus external.
I understand,
that's what you're talking about.
Right, and I do think that if we're saying that we're always looking for the best, and I think we can't really be saying that. And this is no reflection on our inside candidates. And obviously, Mr. Seed has been a great teacher, and I'm sure he'll be an awesome vice principal. But I do think that, in fairness, and then I think for the district, perhaps the school committee could consider articulating that policy so that it parallels the teacher's contract in terms of when we have an opening like that, especially in something of that importance, that we cast the net as wide as we need to, and that's really it. I just think, like I said, if you hear of something and it's something that can be addressed through policy, I would say bring it here. It's a great place to have a discussion about it, but there are good examples. So.
And I think it would, I mean, we don't have to do it at this meeting here, but I think it would be a good idea to consider at a future meeting a policy that you know, it just takes it off the superintendent's plate. He doesn't even have to think about it. That's the policy. Everything has to go on school spring. Externally, right? That would be the key difference to what we do now. And then
maybe we can put that on a future, maybe next meeting, so we don't drag this on. But thank you. That was really superintendent search. Hopefully, did everybody get a chance to kind of look through the materials? I, as chair, would like to appoint a subcommittee to pursue part of this. But there are all kinds of opportunities here that we need to discuss as a committee. One being, you know, what role does the MASC play for us? Will they be the body that casts the net for that first, you know, for candidates and do the initial vetting of the candidates, and then those candidates will come to the subcommittee? That's one approach, as opposed to the subcommittee, you know, or us internally handling that. I think that's certainly a service that they provide, and they obviously...
And that's a good point. So, and I think Joel recently did that in his school district. So there, you could share a lot of information with that. But my quick question is, if we do that with the school committee council, right? Do they they just screen them all and they submit to us who they think.
I think what we need to do is articulate what it is we're looking for,
right,
which would be my next, my next point. I mean, yes, I think what we need to do is articulate what are we looking for, the, you know, the school committee, but also we need to come up with a way of getting input from, and I'm not sure how we would do this, but from each school. Mm-hmm. I think the teachers within each school, perhaps an anonymous thing could go to each principal and then they could submit it to us, mm-hmm, in terms of what are the teachers looking for that next level of leadership, to, you know, and I think that's really important, input. Yeah.
So it's, you know, with everything you're saying, I'm on the same page with you. I would like to see us have a focus group, and a lot of that would do what you're saying, but we would actually have a few nights and where we would open that up to, you know, the teachers maybe after school, the administrators after school, mm-hmm, give them an opportunity to come to a forum, share their thoughts of what they would like, what they would not like, to have somebody taking that information down and do that process in a focus group for, you know, all different aspects of all of our players. So for our citizens, for our students, for our teachers, for our administrators, anybody who's a, you know, a player as far as the school system, you know, has an opportunity to a focus group that they would go to, and then we would get that information and break that down to hear, you know, what is the common threads and trends, right, that the people of Clinton are looking for.
Right. So, yeah, go on.
And I guess I would add to that, I think that's a great idea, to Mr. Mendoza's point, that MASC will tailor the process based on our needs and wants and desires. So I guess what I would add to Mr. McIntyre's proposal is that there should be a dual platform, sort of an online forum, but also an opportunity, mm-hmm, to have a live forum with, mm-hmm, and MASC has and would run something like that, where it's not one of us in the room, it's MASC, right, saying, right, or NESDEC or any one of these organizations that do this as part of an ongoing process. And I think it is in our best interest, it is in the Clinton Public Schools' best interest, and it is especially in the new superintendent's interest to have a thorough vetting process, a thorough needs assessment, mm-hmm, done to give us a sense of what all of these stakeholders need and want in the next school leader. I think having that as an initial step gives us an opportunity to have a clear understanding of the look-fors as we go through the search process. That, you know, it helps to inform the job description to the degree that it can, based on what the current Clinton Public School superintendent has to do, which is immense,
right,
but it also gives us a guide, if you will, that's been vetted by all of the stakeholders to have a sense of what we're looking for qualities.
So, to both your points, I guess I would look for the school committee's approval. I would contact either Glenn or our rep and see what
we budgeted to work with an organization, and it doesn't have to be MASC, but
right,
but you know, we have before us an awesome responsibility, and we have an obligation to do it to the greatest degree possible. And I think that as well-meaning as everyone at this table is, mm-hmm, it might be a little bit bigger than us. And I just,
I think to work in concert
with a group that does this,
right,
I think, you know, it's in our best and the town's best interest.
So yeah. I guess I'm looking for your, I'll make the call tomorrow and see how they propose to do that. Say, you know, we're looking for obviously input for all the various stakeholders. How would they organize it and what can they do for us?
I mean, because one of the questions I have, if they do that, they do the whole process with them. I agree with Joel. It's a big task. It's an awesome responsibility. We want to do the best possible job for the district and the schools and all the stakeholders, obviously.
Right.
But you know, how the resumes are going to come in, who sees them for, that whole process, and he can explain all that to you, right? So, Mr. Kucha, I would assume you're talking.
Right. But I think that that first part,
right,
the input part is because clearly we're going to articulate to them and, you know, what standards we're going to look for anyway in a superintendent.
Mm-hmm. Right.
So what experiences they're going to have, as to Mr. Ngannou's point, you know, they should have classroom experience. It'd be great if they had combination special needs and regular ed backgrounds. The broader the net, the better. But, yes, absolutely.
I guess what I'm saying is, if we're going to have them do it, they're going to say, these are the candidates that we give more data. These are the candidates that we think.
You can ask.
No. But that's why I'm asking.
The top
I think
the top three.
What I'm assuming is that we will end up with them casting a net for the requirements that we're setting, and then that the subcommittee will then wean that down to let's say, three or four finalists that will come to the school committee for the interview.
My experience, Stephen, has been that any candidate that we want to see MAS, any candidate that applies, we can be as involved as we want to be in that process, from initial screening to early interviews to final interviews to negotiating. Now, once we probably don't want to do that as a whole school committee, because it, you know, that is a public process from start to finish.
Right.
I don't think it's time efficient to do
and
it
I,
that
and I
way.
Agree with you. I just want to make sure, because to your point, we want to get the best person, best everything. My experience, all the politics are out of it.
Sure, it, absolutely.
And that's why
my
I'm
experience has been that MASC will work to the level of comfort that that the particular committee and or community has.
Right.
So.
Okay.
I'll call there tomorrow, and I think what I will do is I'll communicate to Terry, and he can send out a letter that way, or note to everybody, and say I don't want to get run afoul of anything with email.
Yeah.
But I think what I'll do is I'll call MASC and find out whether he's going to come back or our rep will come back, you know, for first, you know, for that initial input, and so they can come back with a proposal for us, level of service and what they're going to do and how they would organize the focus groups, what input they need from us for those focus groups, or whether they do them on their own. So why don't I do that, and then I'll let you all know via Terry. You know when they're going to come out. What, you know, whether they be maybe.
Great.
Hopefully they'll be in our next meeting. You know, that would probably we could devote that in our next meeting and see if we can't get this.
Great, thank you.
Into shape.
Mr. Chair, if it may, is their role in this process something that they, you know, they provide the service often? They have a like procedure for how they go about it, or will their role in this process be something we'll discuss with them?
They will be as involved as we would like them.
Exactly.
To be.
Okay. So
we can define that, and I think that that's I think what Mr. Bates was, you know, alluding to. And I think, you know, they can be as involved. So they could literally, you know, present us with three finalists. But I don't think that would be in our interest.
Right.
I do think that the focus groups are essential. Getting the input of the community is essential, and obviously the teachers, the school district, and. And
parents.
I think getting that initial group of candidates would be great, because I think their net would be wider than ours no matter what. And then the subcommittee, which I was, and I'm going to try and keep it small. A lot of people have raised their hand. I want to be out of it. I think having served on at least three of these committees previously, I the smaller the group, the better. And I think it'll be a more workable solution. And I think because we haven't availed ourselves of this service in the past, I think this will be a much more informed process relative.
Right.
I think the focus groups and everything else, we haven't really done that, and I think that would be a much better approach to this process. So.
Yep. I'm just thinking priority-wise, I think that would be one of the first major things that we want to come to an agreement on, is what role they would play, because then, once we get that set in stone, then we're kind of off and running.
Yeah, let me see if I can, Pat Carrera is, I don't know if you all met her, she's sometimes at the
meetings.
Right.
Orientation
meeting I guess, have you been to yours yet?
It's coming up.
Okay, so Pat is our rep, or Glenn Kucher. I'll talk to Pat and ask her whether she would do it, or Glenn, or somebody else entirely, to define that and help us pat this into shape. So I'll shoot for that for the next meeting.
Mm-hmm.
Great. Right.
Thank you.
Okay. So that'd be our September 12th. Okay. So subcommittee assignments, we traditionally have had...
These are last year's in your
yeah,
packet.
Yeah, these are last year's. They're down low in the packet here. I put a note in here. We've had subcommittees. Obviously, all members have been policy and procedures. Community scholarship is really at the end, towards the graduation. We usually have one person sit in on that. It's a great responsibility, and I think it's a real eye-opener for the letters that are submitted and the work the kids do. Mr. Hastings and the guidance counselors all sit in. Come up with a scholarship awards curriculum. I'm
expanding that, Robert, a little bit.
That would be awesome, because we didn't have very many meetings. I would certainly like to serve on that again.
Yes.
I don't know.
I hope to do every other month, so just to let somebody know that.
If you can,
I love hearing about the things that are going on, but I'm happy to give that to someone else who also has an interest in curriculum, if there's anyone else.
Does anybody have any interest in we're non-voting members, but we do have input in that process, and it is a good way to keep your ear to the ground as to what's going on.
Traditionally, it's been curriculum only, and with the lack of money, there's been very little new courses and changes in the curriculum. So it's got to expand into more professional development, and also kind of what's happening in the whole school district. And we need to kind of solidify that better. So traditionally it was like 3 meetings a year. I want to do like October, December, February, April, and June.
Which would be great.
After school, like 2:30, 3 o'clock maybe.
Yeah, 3 o'clock would be.
Something like
that.
So I'm happy to continue, but I'll defer to someone else, another member, if they have an interest.
Does anybody have a leaning that way?
I have an interest, but I can, with me being first year, I think that I have an area of understanding for my job from curriculum, so I can hold off.
Okay.
Respect Joel's expertise there as well, and with you. But in the future, I would be interested.
All right. It comes up every year, so.
Yeah.
It doesn't go away.
Yeah. Everybody else all right with that? Or did you?
I'm fine with that.
Okay.
I just don't have time.
Hmm?
I'm just busy. I can't do that.
Okay.
I think you guys are doing a good job.
So, Michael, every year we do this facilities review, and people take on a tour of the various facilities and do a report back to the school committee. I'm sure you're aware of this in state of facilities. And so we've had the various schools, the administration center, and the fields. Last year, Mr. Bates did the elementary school on the fields. I don't know if you're not available. You are.
I enjoy it.
Yeah.
There's nothing better than going around the different campuses and seeing how much pride the folks take in the work that they've done over the summer and getting schools ready. But I don't know if I can do it this year with the time that I have left.
Yeah. You available for any of that?
To work on the facilities committee, absolutely.
Yeah. So I mean,
Robert, I don't think it has to be done like before school starts.
No, but I'd like to get the assignments done. So you don't have to do it tomorrow or anything.
Yeah,
but
I think it could wait till the first week or two of school.
Oh well,
it doesn't have to be done tomorrow.
Yeah, traditionally we do it before. So if it doesn't have to be done before, then
then so okay.
So how do you want to do it?
Why don't we have that report, since maybe the end of September, after school has started. And actually, that might not be bad, as school starts and issues come up, obviously, that you're looking, you'll hear more about what's working,
school
what's not working.
School principals, do the custodians have that kind of flexibility to walk us around for an hour or so once school starts?
At your leisure, Mr. Bates.
That's a good answer.
Obviously, they do. It would be easier for them if it was done, prior to school, because we only all have one custodian in the daytime.
Well, how soon they were there? They were there early, right? They like at 6 or 7. They're there early, right?
Yeah.
Before 7 o'clock.
Works for me.
So
early works for me.
Okay. I'll tell you what.
Either
so
way.
early is better.
Do you want to stay with the elementary school then?
Do you want the elementary school?
I don't. Either any of the schools is fine with me.
Well, Ed had two schools last year, so easy to divide it up.
I'll keep the elementary, and if Mike wants the middle school or the high school or something else.
Just give me one.
I'll do the middle school.
All right. So this is still, and do you want to do the high school?
Sure.
So Mike.
Mike is high school?
Yes.
Yeah.
Okay.
Do you want to?
Give me one if you want to give me one. Whatever you want to give me. I'm flexible.
You can take Shields.
Do you want to do the fields? Do you want to do the, you know, outdoor?
Yeah, I can do that.
Okay.
So that would include all the fields, right?
Fields. Okay.
And I'll do the administration building again.
Okay. Let me know. I can do that on Saturday or Sunday if you'd like.
So I don't believe we have any negotiations imminent.
No, we do have the paraprofessionals, the instructional associates that will. I want to move it along this year, so
we'll
probably start in the fall. Traditionally, it's been like during the day or late afternoon.
I can do late afternoon.
Okay, so you want to do that?
Yeah. Unless someone would rather do it, I mean, it's up, you know.
Be the paras, the instructional assistants.
Negotiations.
Oh.
Hmm?
Well, they're separate. When does that start?
We don't know. They need to send me a letter by October 1st, but hopefully we'll move it along. But that's the only other contract left.
Right. If someone has an interest, I mean, it's
in negotiations.
Yeah, but I mean, I've had probably more experience than any of the members, and I just assume half the other people have that experience because there are bigger contracts.
You need two people, right?
So just one.
Just one. Yeah. You want to try it?
Yeah.
I'm going to try it.
You would?
Yeah.
Sure.
All right.
So Ed will do it.
Keep what you wish for.
Maybe we know who's not going to be there. So safety committee, last year was Stephen and Joel. I don't know if you want to stay that way or if Mike wants to step in to one of them. Or Steve's had an active interest in safety for the district.
More meetings.
Again, I'm happy to continue to serve, but will be happily defer to someone who has interest.
Do you want to try that?
Sure, I would be happy to.
So Mike, we'll have Mike, and we'll keep Joel in the curriculum.
Okay. Safety.
And safety, we're going to say Stephen and Mike.
Steve, yes.
And Ed's going to do negotiations. And I'm going to hold off on appointing that search committee for the superintendent until after we get some more input. So, marketing subcommittee.
So we end up meeting Terry like four times maybe
I'd
over the summer.
Four
so
times,
we're pretty busy. Mr. Morrison, Terry, Steve, among others. We kind of the first couple meetings we focused in on existing ways of communication, ways that they can be improved. One of the things we talked about was attempting to standardize the website, specifically like as a parent or something, we'll be going through it, the teachers and the athletic teams, trying to put together a template. Right now, teachers do a good job, but everything is kind of like the Wild West in terms of like what one page could look like compared to another. So what we talked about at that meeting was possibly standardizing those web pages and working with the teachers to do that. We started getting into using the digital media department for some marketing initiatives. One of the things we had a list of ideas that we went over, but one of the things we decided that it would be good thing to try to pilot would be the school like a monthly school news program.
Great.
So we're going to start talking about the format of the show. Mr. Morris could probably speak to. They did something similar to this a couple years ago. What was it? The Revolution?
Yeah, it was based out of the high school. Maybe you dealt with high school stuff.
Right. So this will be something similar to that. We're still going to work on how the format's going to work, but some of the ideas were to have like a student of the month or teacher of the month or historic, you know, this month in history in Clinton type of thing. So it's all open for ideas, but that's the that's one of the ideas that we definitely want to try to push for this year. And then if we're successful with that, We'll branch out into others, and we've had a lot of support from the town on this, because we're going to be supplying content to the public access cable
Great.
Channel.
Great.
So everything's, we're still talking to them on the details of how that collaboration is going to work, but initially they're interested in helping us out and in regards to equipment and compensating some students who are filming like off school hours if they have to, you know, travel to like 10, 11 o'clock at night for an away game. So they're open to that right now. That's going to be huge, and I think it's another good opportunity for the schools and the town to work together. So
great,
that was about it. And I think we plan on continuing to try to meet every other Thursday.
That's great.
I think we're making some pretty good progress.
Yeah, we're getting there.
Sounds great. Awesome. This is under old business. I just have a question. So there was a blood drive that sort of didn't work out on a weekend day, and my question is the air conditioning working now? Is what happened?
It was not Monday morning.
It wasn't the air conditioning wasn't working. It wasn't
scheduled to be
so
on.
So I understand, yeah. but so there wasn't anything more serious than that. No one knew how to modify the timer.
Well, they came.
I was there.
I was here.
They just came back today.
Oh.
We asked them to come back, Glenn, and he was so backed up that he did come back today. I left and he was still here, so I'm not sure exactly how. So it wasn't that there wasn't AC, it was that
it wouldn't function. It was just it went into weekend mode and we couldn't override it.
Right. Okay, I just want to make sure it wasn't something more serious, because it sounded almost, I couldn't
Even
tell
Monday,
if it was just,
hey, time, so.
There you go. Oh, well,
it was unfortunate.
I know it was unfortunate, because usually weekdays I can't do it.
It happens. Paul, he talked Friday, checked the room, the cafeteria is where they were going to do it, it was perfect.
Right.
He just would never think, because, I didn't hear a lot on the weekend, so probably somewhere back when, 2007, I think was the last time I looked.
And you've but, always done it in the gym in the past.
As opposed to the winter, the heat is indeed on.
Right. And I have to say the volunteers and everybody involved kept a positive attitude.
Yeah, it was great.
It was just unfortunate it didn't work out, but everybody kept a good smile on their face. So I just was curious what, but it's good to hear it was just a timer. Anything under new business?
Just opening day is Monday. School committee is invited. We have refreshments from Mr. Vanasse and his crew from 7:30 to 8 at Clinton High School. And then greetings from hopefully the school committee, the PTA, and other groups for starters. And a little presentation from, we'll say, till probably hopefully 9:30 at the latest. And then we do, various faculty meetings, union meetings, and all kinds of things that go on. Afternoons are usually spent, fixing up the rooms and counting books and all of that. But certainly the school committee is invited to the opening day ceremonies.
I'll have very few remarks, but I'll have
some. Okay. I think the faculty will appreciate that.
Yes, I think everybody appreciates a few words. Try to make it very few. There anything else under any public comments? Yes.
I just wanted to say that the special education department had a very successful summer. We ran a wonderful summer program for extended school year. We came up with a name for our ABA program, so now instead of calling it ABA, we're going to call it Connections. So all the programs at the elementary school and now the middle school will be called the Connections program. And I wanted to highlight one program we ran this summer for our Connections program that combined some of our special needs kids with some of our typical kids in the district that taught social skills, and we used our typical kids as role models. And I have to tell you, both staff and students had a blast. It was a summer camp kind of format. And from what I've heard from both the parents and the students who were there and from the teachers who taught it, a good time was had by all. And I ran for 5 weeks, and I have an expectation that it'll probably be bigger next summer. So I'm looking forward to seeing what happens.
Great.
Just thought you might
come. Yes. That's good. Thank you.
Just a reminder, tomorrow night, or actually tomorrow from 4 to 6, at the middle school, is our welcome back PBIS barbecue. Our hopes are to give out 7th and 8th grade schedules, but that's not looking so promising right now, because when we went to run them today, for some reason here, the computer that they hooked up to the printer is a glitch. So to run 742 schedules, it just didn't do it. It
was
on
the small printer. Yeah, yeah,
it was on.
Okay.
But barbecue is tomorrow. We have face painting, music, games.
So for the people who can't hear this back there, so the Clinton Middle School will have a barbecue, the PBIS program barbecue, at from what time? From 4? 4 to 6?
Yes.
4 to 6. It's going to be a nice day, and you might have your schedule.
And it's $3 if you want to eat, otherwise it's free if you just want to come in for games, music, face painting, and tours.
Okay. Yes?
I forgot to mention, the PTA is also having the school kids picked up tomorrow evening from 4 to 6 at the middle school, and at the elementary school, we're going to pick up from 4 to 6 also.
And what are they picking up?
Parents could order
school supplies.
School supplies, okay, PTA school supplies. Okay, so the same time at the middle school?
Same time as the
PBIS barbecue.
And then the following night at elementary school. But if they have
that,
is it at the middle school?
Both nights at the middle
school. Oh, okay, sorry. So it's both nights at the middle school. You can come if you have an elementary school or a middle school student.
Okay, so elementary or middle school students. Kit pickups at the middle school.
I just realized that the open houses, except for the high school, the elementary and middle school open houses are before our next meeting, so good luck with those.
Is there anything else? So we're going to go into executive session to discuss a proposed contract. So under Chapter 38, Section 21 of Mass General Laws, Open Meeting Law, the committee will enter an executive session to discuss these negotiations, and we will not reconvene. I believe, right?
Yep.
Okay. So Joel Bates, aye.
Second.
Yeah, say your name. It's a voice.
Mike Mantair.
Okay. Robert Epstein, aye.
Ed DeVault, aye.
Stephen Mendoza will recuse himself from the meeting.
Oh, and before we leave, I wanted to congratulate Mr. Mendoza, whose daughter was married. I should have mentioned it earlier, but congratulations.
Yes.
Two left.
Start saving.
They never really leave, right?